Good morning. I'm Daniela Gratali, Director of the Office of Child Health Policy and Advocacy at Nemours Children's Health. Nemours is one of the nation's largest multi-state pediatric health systems with two freestanding children's hospitals and a network of nearly 80 primary and specialty care clinics across 5 states. Nemours seeks to transform the health of children by adopting a holistic health model that utilizes innovative, safe, and high quality care while also caring for the health of the whole child beyond medicine. Thank you for joining us today for our discussion on Building Back Better for children and youth. We are pleased to participate in Children's Week, which is an event sponsored by our partners at First Focus on Children. We also thank our briefing co-sponsors, including First Focus on Children, Mental Health America, the Forum for Youth Investment, the Education Redesign Lab at Harvard University, and Children's Funding Project. Today's briefing is divided into multiple segments covering state-level bright spots, federal coordination, policy recommendations for the Biden-Harris administration, and finally, a Q&A. Please send in your questions through the chat function throughout the briefing. Our first segment will spotlight what states have done to make government work better for children and youth. We will begin with opening comments from Senator Angus King. Senator King is Maine's first independent senator. He was sworn into office in January of 2013 and is a member of the Armed Services Committee, the Select Committee on Intelligence, the Committee on Energy and Natural Resources, and the Committee on Rules and Administration. Previously, he served as the 72nd governor of Maine, and it was in that capacity that he established Maine's Children's Cabinet. It is my honor to turn it over to Senator King.
It's been my experience working in government for off and on now for 25 years that one of our problems is silos. Quite often they can be really good silos. They can be excellent silos, but they're still silos. And back in 1996 in Maine, when I was governor, we talked about this problem of silos. And my wife, Mary Herman, who had worked in public policy in Maine for the 15 or 20 years before she found herself married to the governor, suggested, why don't we form something called a children's cabinet to bring together the departments that deal with children's issues? And that's the origin of the idea of the children's cabinet. 1996, it was Mary Herman's idea. And, you know, I was the governor, so we could make it happen. And Governor Mills has now really brought the idea of the Children's Cabinet back to the fore, reestablished it. It was put into statute, has reestablished it. And to me, it just makes common sense. If you've got four or five agencies dealing with the same kinds of issues, different aspects, of course, whether it's mental health, education, health and human services, corrections, I mean, you've got all of these pieces that are dealing with these issues, let's at least have them talk to each other. Because one of the things we found in Maine was that you'd have a family with some fairly serious issue, and they could be visited by three or four different people from different agencies, sometimes with different advice. And so the whole idea of the Children's Cabinet is to try to reduce that kind of redundancy, to deliver more coordinated services, and frankly, be more efficient with the taxpayers' dollars. So the origin of the Children's Cabinet started with Mary, my wife, and then I was fortunate enough to be able to put it into place with some wonderful commissioners at that time. Governor Mills has now reconstituted it, and I know that it's working now in Maine. I commend the idea to any state because, again, you have these, as I say, this is not criticizing the Department of Education or the Department of Mental Health or social services, human services. Everybody's doing the best they can, but sometimes they're not talking to each other. And that's what the Children's Cabinet is all about.
Thank you, Senator King. I'm now delighted to introduce the panelists for the second part of our state level segment. Joining us are Senator Tom Carper, Dr. Kara Odom Walker, and Joshua Ogburn. Senator Carper's career in public service began in 1976 when he was elected to the first of three terms as Delaware State Treasurer at the age of 29. He later served five terms in the United States House of Representatives and two terms as Delaware's governor before joining the United States Senate, where he now serves as Delaware's senior senator. Interestingly, like Senator King, while governor, Senator Carper created a coordinating body called the Family Services Cabinet Council. Our next panelist, Dr. Kara Odom Walker, actually served on Delaware's Family Services Cabinet Council previously. Dr. Kara Odom Walker is the Chief Population Health Officer and Executive Vice President at Nemours Children's Health. Previously, she served as the Secretary of the Delaware Department of Health and Social Services and as Deputy Chief Science Officer at the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute. She is a board-certified practicing family physician and is a fellow of the American Academy of Family Physicians. Facilitating the discussion between Senator Carper and Dr. Walker is Joshua Ogburn, who is the Manager of Policy in the National Office of Nemours Children's Health System. Previously, Joshua served as the Project Director of RVA Childhood Asthma Initiative, as well as Director of the University of Virginia Pay for Success Lab. I'll now turn it over to Josh.
Hello, Senator Carper, Dr. Walker. Nice to be here with you today. We are here to discuss children's cabinets, what they are, why governors and other executive branch leaders at the local, state, and federal level may utilize them, and specifically both of your experiences with the Delaware Family Services Cabinet Council. So, Senator Carper, you launched the Family Services Cabinet Council in 1993 during your first year as governor. Can you describe why you launched it and what you hoped it would accomplish for children and families?
Yeah, I was elected governor of Delaware in November of 92, became governor in January of 93. I remember going to an event about a month after the election in 92. Mike Castle had been our governor. He was elected to Congress, my job. I was congressman, elected to his job, governor. It's like trading places, like the movie. And but we were at a dinner together, maybe in November or December of 1992, right after the election. And we were asked by the person who was like the MC at the dinner for Governor Castle about to become Congressman Castle, Congressman Carper about to become Governor Carper. We each asked to say, what if we had a magic wand? If we had a magic wand, what would we do with that magic wand and our new jobs? And I don't remember what Mike Castle said. I remember what I said. I said I would try to take my magic wand. I'd try to make sure that every child in our state had at least one, maybe two, hopefully two loving, caring, nurturing parents. That's what I would do, and it was to strengthen families. The dinner proceeded and was over, and then the next month, he sworn in as congressman, I sworn in as governor of Delaware. I've been governor about a month, and one of the people that I asked to stay on from Congress, former governor Castle's cabinet, to stay with me in my administration, was a fellow named Tom Eichler, a Republican. And we had a department called the Department of Children, Youth, and Family, and Tom Eichler had been the Secretary of the Department of Health and Social Services, the job that you held for a number of years. And he came to see me one day as the new Cabinet Secretary of what we lovingly call the Kids Department. And he said, Governor, I have an idea. He said, you know, you want to have an administration that's focused on strengthening the basic building blocks of our family, our families. And he said, I have an idea. And he laid out this vision of a Family Services Cabinet Council that would be comprised of the secretaries of about seven different departments in state government: Department of Health and Social Services, Department of Children, Youth and Families, Department of Public Safety, Department of Education, on and on, about seven different departments. He said, you as governor would meet with the cabinet heads once a month, and then once a month they would meet separately without you. And together you jointly create an agenda, really a strategy, for addressing not the symptoms of problems with our society, but why don't we focus on the root causes? And that's exactly what we did. And staffing that for me was a woman named Lisa Bradley at the time. And she had been a member of my staff on my House seat as a congressman. And I asked her to come with me to the governor's office, and she did. She wrote point on this initiative. Our deputy secretary, deputy chief of staff, was John Carney, who's now our governor, and later became our our Secretary of Finance, Lisa, later became Deputy Secretary of Health and Social Services, and also then Deputy, she can be a Secretary of Labor. But we focused, like, for the next 7 years, every month, with the Family Services Cabinet Council, developing an agenda, what we're going to work on, and trying to get rid of the stovepipes between the different agencies. And the 1 month I would meet with them, we'd figure out what are we doing to reduce teenage pregnancy, what are we doing to enhance parenting training, you know, and what are we doing to reduce recidivism in the prisons and make sure when people are released as prisoners back into the society, most of them are parents, have children, and they can come out as better parents or not. What are we doing for early childhood? We found out in Delaware that probably half of the kids in Delaware that are eligible in Head Start were not funded. There's not enough federal funding to fund them. We funded them with state money. We decided to put money into early childhood and above and beyond Head Start to work on kids and literally in districts and families where we knew these kids would be struggling because we'd seen how their older siblings had performed in school not well. So the idea was to provide early childhood support there. We heard about a program, we sold some ideas, we heard about a program in Missouri where people who were trained to teach parents, new parents, how to be a parent, how to nurture a child and bring a child into the world and raise them, prepare them for kindergarten and school. And we took that program and we put it in Delaware, stole the Missouri program and put it in Delaware. We had like, I think, 3,000 family visits. We had just, and then we did parenting training in schools as well. People, just because they have a kid at the age of 16, 17, or 18, 19, doesn't mean they know how to raise that child. And there's a, I forget whose statistic this is, but I heard it just the other day. If a 16-year-old girl becomes pregnant, drops out of school, does not marry, there's about a 80% likelihood that mom, that child, will grow up in poverty. That same girl did not become pregnant at the age of 16, graduates from high school, waits till he's 21 to have a child. There's about an 8% likelihood that they will live in poverty. So we just took that as like, it's pretty clear what needs to happen here, and we focused a lot on that. We put a public school nurse in every public school in Delaware. We began putting in our high schools, wellness centers in our high schools, and some parents were skeptical of wellness centers. They thought we were going to be doing abortions in the cafeteria and contraceptives in the cafeteria, abortions in the auditorium, and that's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to make sure that the young girls and boys made the right mistakes, smart, not the, the made the right decisions, so they wouldn't bring children into the world when they're not ready to be parents. Those are just some of the initiatives that we started. Mentoring programs for many kids that really don't have a good role model in their life. Maybe somebody in their school, maybe a teacher, a principal, coach, but they may not have, unfortunately, anybody in their home. You've got some cases, often a mom raising 3, 4, 5 kids, sometimes without any help, trying to get those kids educated, stay out of trouble. And a lot of kids just need a mentor. And we recruited 10,000 mentors. I became a mentor. And we would do high schools would mentor elementary schools. Businesses would adopt schools. Churches would adopt schools. Synagogues would adopt schools and provide mentors in the case of businesses on company time. And we actually measured whether or not this stuff was working. It's all well and good. It feels good. It sounds good. It seems to make sense. And it worked. And the year after I stepped down as governor, a gal named, a woman named Peg Bradley, who'd been my education advisor, I don't know if you ever met her, but she's a wonderful woman. She'd been an educator, early childhood educator, and became a state legislator, and then she became my advisor on education in the governor's office. She's a huge focus on early childhood. But there was a longitudinal study done of kids who'd actually had the chance to go through some of the programs and everything that I just laid out. And we found out that the kids after the third grade who'd actually had the benefit of this intervention, this kind of education, they were doing as well as kids from like intact two-parent families. It worked. And I always like to say, find out what works, do more of that. The person who's succeeding as governor, you know, governors have their own priorities. And I had my priorities. My priority was strengthening families. We did a lot on economic development and other things as well, education. But governors, newly elected governors, have different priorities. And the next governor or two, they're good, very good governors, but that or the Family Services Cabinet Council was not one of their priorities. And but God bless John Carney.
I agree.
Yes, John Carney, who had been my deputy chief of staff when I was governor, who's my secretary of finance when I was governor. I love the guy like a brother, and he's now our governor. And he saw what the Family Services Cabinet Council did, could do, and he's brought it back. And
I was so fortunate to work in that model and framing that Governor Carney reestablished. And I remember you and I talked about what we could do with this new vision, and really did embrace the same model, the same people around the table, but every month we could tackle the most difficult issues for Delaware. And that included issues around the opioid crisis and how you address at-risk kids, violence in our communities, and how we really think about ensuring everyone has equal access to jobs. I think out of that came work around trauma-informed care, trauma awareness, and took on a large statewide initiative to make sure that every agency had a training and some tools in their toolkit around trauma. And so having that conversation is important. And I think you also said during that first set of months when I was trying to figure out my way as Secretary of Health and how to help uplift our families, how do we really make sure we're supporting those who don't have the right start at the beginning? And if you want to look at your priorities, look at where your budget is. So we would talk about our budget, talk about our programs, talk about where we had duplication and synergy across our agencies. I think, you know, having that leadership is critically important. Having it at the cabinet level is immeasurable. And then having leadership from the governor or from our president even maybe one day that would allow these conversations to happen would be such a tremendous tool for our kids to invest in the healthiest generation of children going forward, emerge from the pandemic. But I also want to highlight that having that structure in place to deal with COVID-19 was essential. It allowed us to quickly respond, to figure out where we all had agency roles and perspectives and tools and resources to really push forward with what was necessary and needed in communities of need. I can't imagine not having that conversation on a monthly basis. And obviously during COVID, it was more like weekly, where we would all come together.
There's one of my favorite sayings is that teamwork makes the dream work. And the magic behind the Family Services Cabinet Council is we brought together on a regular basis the chief decision makers, the leaders in our state, who touch family lives and children's lives every day. And the idea to know that this is governor's priority, whether the governor's Don Carney or Tom Carper or somebody else, and to make sure that the expectation was that we would collaborate across departmental lines. Two of my favorite colleagues, I've been blessed with a lot of colleagues in the military and the Navy, but also as governor and in the Senate and so forth. One of my colleagues as governor is a guy named Zell Miller from Georgia, Democrat, sort of a blue dog Democrat. You know, he's a Democrat, but fiscally conservative and kind of old school. But he was really good on education, really good on education. We served together as governors for years. I was chair of the NGA, and he was a senior person in NGA as well, National Governors Association. I remember once he said to all of us, he said, if talking about education funding, he said, if I had to do it all over again in Georgia, we would, and he said it was partly tongue-in-cheek, but in front of fact, but he said, we would not fund the 12th grade. We'd take all that money, and we'd fund it in 0-5. We'd put it there because he said that's where that's where we need to make the difference, and that's where we're falling short. And that's a bit. He was saying that to get people's attention, but there's actually a lot of truth to that. The other thing I remember having a colloquy on the Senate floor, where I was talking to Chris Dodd from Connecticut and myself. He was chairman of the Banking Committee. I served on committee with him, and we were debating education legislation on the floor in early childhood. And I mentioned he was managing the bill. I mentioned how many words the kids learn before the age of like 4 or 5, and I said several, like thousands, like tens of thousands, and Chris thought, no, it's something like 80 or 90 by the time they're 6, and if we waste those first 4, 5, 6 years, it's hard to get them back, and that's why you need to make the investment early.
Right, and we know, you know, in the science, brain science matters, investing earlier matters, but we also know the dollars for those earliest years are all fragmented out in the federal government and in state agencies too. And so trying to figure out how to prioritize that, it's one of the reasons Nemours is really pushing for this idea of leadership that collects the expertise around the table around investing in children and youth, because we know those experiences are real and agencies have a lot of priorities. But if you can start early, think about prevention. Prevention isn't always the top issue for many agencies, that maybe we'd have a chance to create kind of a long-term payoff. We know that, you know, those early years actually predict more than anything else we do in healthcare, how long someone lives and what their socioeconomic status is. Just to your example, how do we really start early, I think, is a key question. But bringing leaders together around that shared priority could be one step in that direction.
Yeah. I mentioned mostly children of color, boys, and mostly African-American, but some Latino. And I have maybe half dozen kids over the last 20-some years. And I never mentored a young boy who had a father in his house. And never. And he had a lot of, frankly, heroic moms. And but everything was on them or on grandma. And there's too many kids who just don't haven't seen what it's like to live in a home where a man loved a woman, how he treated that woman, or how a woman should expect to be treated. And we have like all kinds of people in my generation, the boomers, that their working careers from a large overdone behind them. They don't want to just go play golf. They just want to have some meaning in their life. They could be a mentor. Mm-hmm. They could be a mentor and find meaning in their life and feel that they're still contributing for a child who needs them. And the mentor, it's like somebody drops out of the sky and comes to your school when you're a little kid, and they're not getting paid, they're not a teacher, they're not a coach, they're not there because they have to, they're there because they care about the kid. It makes huge difference, huge impact.
Yeah, it kind of speaks to a larger question or a larger topic with children's cabinets. You know, we talked about a lot of ways that the cabinets have helped, that the Family Services Cabinet Council helped in Delaware, and really bringing together, as you said, health, education, agriculture, commerce, transportation, even around the same table, like we're sitting here today, and to work on issues. So, you know, can you speak a little bit to how sort of functionally the cabinet was able to achieve some of these objectives that otherwise wouldn't have been possible if everyone was operating in their own, you know, agency buildings or...
Mm-hmm. Well, fortunately, Delaware was a little state. Healthcare knows we're like 100 miles from north to south, or about 50 miles wide, and their capital is Dover, right in the middle of the state. So this is before we did a lot of Zooms, but now that we have Zooms and capability to do that, governors can call their cabinets together anytime, day or night, and that's a great tool. But we had Lisa Blunt Rochester, then Lisa Blunt Bradley was the point person on this in my office. And later, when she became Deputy Cabinet Secretary, another woman on our staff, wonderful woman, stepped up and took the reins. But what was really important was making sure we had somebody working at a senior level in the governor's office that all the cabinet members knew, had my trust, my confidence, and my expectations, and was sort of empowered to ride herd is probably the wrong word, but to ride herd. And if someone was not producing, let me know, not in a mean-spirited way, but let's say, you know, so-and-so, they have a prison riot right now. They got other things to worry about, but they need to be continued to focus on parenting and working with our prisoners.
There's so many priorities that come to you as governor to have a children's cabinet, a family services cabinet council able to sift through what needs to keep moving forward, I think, is incredibly powerful.
I got to lead the trade delegations. I once led a trade delegation to Israel. I met with the new mayor, Barak, the new prime minister, right after he was elected. Had lunch with the guy who was the leader of the Palestinian community, and Arafat. And literally presented to him as governor of Delaware on behalf of Bill Clinton a roadmap to normalize relations between the Israelis and the Palestinians. I mean, like, his other duties as assigned. So it's an interesting life. It's a great life.
All comes together. And I think we've also explored a little bit about even bringing in folks at the federal level from an international perspective into a cabinet like that.
I like to see, find out what works, do more of that. And that's
straightforward.
And the states, Bill Clinton used to say, the states are laboratories of democracy. And some state, I'd say to my cabinet, my team, I'd say, when we're dealing with a particular issue in Delaware, I'd say, some other governor, some other state has figured out how to do this. Right. And what we need to do is find that governor, find that state, find out how he did it. Is it transferable? How do we make it work in Delaware?
Right. And then sort of as we think sort of to the federal level, right, they talk about the states being the laboratories of democracy. You bring the best ideas from the states, perhaps up to the federal level. So as we think about, you know, lessons from Delaware, lessons from other places around the country, sort of how would you see something like this potentially operating and be helpful at the federal level? Maybe speaking to some of the lessons that you learned from the state around having a high-level person in charge, mm-hmm. direction from the executive. How would you see that potentially
I got mentioned this in early in this conversation, but one of the things we found is key to raising student achievement is early childhood opportunity, not just mentoring, but the other thing that we found that worked was extra learning time. Extra learning time. It could be a longer school day for some kids. Mm-hmm. It could be like just some school on weekend. It could be like summer school. And one of the things we put in Congress, we put in our last major COVID package, we put in there a lot of money for summer school. And not just for babysitting, but actually transportation to get kids to school starting in June, this month. Feed them breakfast, feed them lunch, and to have rigor, math, science, English, social studies in school throughout the summer. So these kids who have lost a whole year have a chance to regain it. That's a role for the federal government. I think the role of the federal government is to level the playing field for kids that are the whole lives are like going uphill. That's just one example of what we've done in real time to help in this regard.
Hmm. Yeah, the American Rescue Plan has certainly made a huge down payment in us getting to more equitable outcomes, hmm. to level investment for kids to be able to achieve in education, in their lives and communities. And I think it's one way that we definitely can see states trying to put a plan together to ensure that they are moving forward around equity and investing in children and youth. There's a lot of dollars for families around childcare, around leave, around how we really make sure that there are programs touching each other to make sure that we're paying attention. So it might be some kind of a data, it might be a leadership entity, it might be some other report that comes out of OMB that we really think about how these priorities and budgets align, because I think the investment that has been made in the American Rescue Plan Act has been tremendous to get us started and continue that momentum forward. But I don't know if you see like a next phase coming out of those investments to emerge from the pandemic in ways that will really help our families.
There's probably a dozen or so governors, former governors who are U.S. senators. And we don't have a formal caucus, but we're sort of like an informal group. And we tend to govern from the middle. A lot of us were actually involved in the Mark Warner's one. Mm-hmm. We were both chairs of the National Governors Association. One of the things that I've done as we're crafting these legislative packages is to reach out to the governors, the Governors Association, and to say, all right, this is what we're thinking of doing. Do you have some help? Can you give us some advice? We're trying to figure out what to do on unemployment benefits, federal unemployment benefits and supplement, which has been a source of real confrontation and disagreement. As it turns out, there's an association of former secretaries of labor, like Lisa, former secretaries of labor. And we reached out to them and said we're trying to figure out how to structure the unemployment, supplemental unemployment benefits. It's $300 a month. When do we phase it out? When do we phase it down? Give us some ideas. So the idea is to actually be involved in a conversation with the key organizations. And you've got those in the National Governors Association, National Association you are a part of, is our Secretary of Health and Social Services, Labor Secretary. And for those organizations to not hide their candle under a bushel, but they have their own senators, they all have their own senators, they have relationships there, but to use their powers of persuasion and to be active participants, and for us to be good listeners.
Yeah.
Again, in the words of Bill Clinton, find out what works, do more of that, and the states as laboratories of democracy.
Yeah. Well, I think that really speaks to potentially the promise of a children's cabinet at the federal level, taking what has worked in Delaware and going from there. So
we got a great president right now. I love Joe Biden. I met him when I was 28 years old, and I was right out of the Navy, back from Southeast Asia, moved to Delaware, and like 2 years after reading about him overseas in Southeast Asia, I read about Joe Biden winning election at the age of 29 to be U.S. senator. I thought, what an amazing guy. 2 years later, I was in his living room. As a graduate student and treasurer and fundraiser for a Democratic candidate run for Congress. And we've had a number of governors who have been presidents, and we'll have others in the future. And most likely they'll be a woman, and probably a pretty good one. And the governors, when you have a governor as president, that's when this stuff can really cook and really get some juice going.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for sharing a little bit about your experience.
I would spend the rest of this day talking to you guys. I love this stuff.
Fantastic.
What a blessing to be able to do this and to know that people still care about it and or think that this maybe will be helpful as we move forward and come out of the pandemic. It's great. There's an old saying, Einstein, in adversity lies opportunity. In adversity lies opportunity. Huge adversity, but great opportunity here. We just have to be smart enough to seize the day.
Thank you for your leadership.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you to our distinguished panelists for their presentations and to Senator Carper and Senator King for their leadership in creating coordinating entities in their respective states. I am now delighted to introduce our second segment on federal coordination. We are honored to be joined today by Bryan Samuels, Robert Shea, and Mary Ellen Wiggins, all of whom have served in the federal government. Bryan Samuels is the executive director of Chapin Hall at the University of Chicago. Prior to joining Chapin Hall, he was the commissioner of the Administration for Children, Youth, and Families at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In that capacity, he administered federal programs addressing child abuse and neglect, runaway and homeless youth, domestic and intimate partner violence, and teen pregnancy. Previously, he served as the chief of staff at Chicago Public Schools and as director of the Illinois Department of Child and Family Services. Joining him will be Robert Shea, who is National Managing Principal for Public Policy at Grant Thornton. Previously, he spent 15 years in the federal government, including 6 years as the Associate Director for the Office of Management and Budget, where he oversaw programs to implement large-scale personnel reform. Prior to his time at OMB, he served as the Senior Management Counsel for the Senate Committee on Governmental Affairs, and before that, as the Legislative Director for Congressman Pete Sessions. Mary Ellen Wiggins will facilitate this panel. She is the Director of Policy and Research at the Forum for Youth Investment. Previously, she worked at the White House Office of Management and Budget, playing key roles on their evidence, performance, and community solutions teams.
I am so excited to be here today. Welcome to everyone who is joining us online, and a special welcome to each of you, Bryan and Robert. I could not be more delighted to get to share this space with both of y'all. I'm such an admirer of your leadership over the years, and I think we're really going to have an exciting conversation. Bryan, you're such a deep expert in children and youth policy in particular, and Robert, you're such a deep expert in just thinking about management and the structures that can work across government agencies. So I think that's going to be just a really fascinating conversation for this panel today. So let's dive in with that. The first thing that I would love to hear your thoughts on is just why does coordination across agencies actually matter for children and youth? Like, what are the things that are going wrong when we don't have that happening? And Robert, let's start with you as the expert on coordination.
So thanks for that question, Mary Ellen, and I'm delighted to be here with both of you, and thanks to everyone who's tuning in. One of the things that Daniela mentioned, I worked at the Senate Government Affairs Committee. One of the things that committee has commissioned is a study of overlap and duplication across the government, which is a major problem. Just to give you some examples, their housing assistance is fragmented across 160 programs and activities across the government. 80 federal programs in 8 different agencies fund a variety of transportation services. Federal early learning and child care support for children from birth through age 5 is administered through 45 programs. So, you know, even in each of those slices, transportation, housing, early childhood learning, there's overlap and duplication for which coordination is required. We need to coordinate in order to find out what practices are most effective, proven to be most effective, what emerging challenges to those communities exist. But as both of you know, the problems facing children and youth aren't limited to those silos. Taking a whole of person approach, you've got to take benefits from each of those areas. And so when communities are faced with trying to address the challenges of those individuals, they've got to go through this bureaucratic labyrinth to access those benefits, and it just wastes a lot of resources. All of these programs are well-intended. Many of them are showing enormous benefits, even when subjected to rigorous evaluation methodologies. But there's so much more we could learn, so much greater impact we could have with greater collaboration and coordination across these programs.
Yeah, so my experience is slightly different than Robert's, but we'll get to find that common ground somewhere between now and the end of this discussion. But you know, my experience in the federal government was less about the concerns that they were overlapping and duplicating programs, and more likely to be the case that there were gaps between programs and policies. So the experiences that I had working at HHS and collaborating across the federal government was that because there were such different definitions of who is eligible for services or what services could be provided or under what circumstances they could be provided, then often it was the case that there wasn't enough space to tie the programs together and create holistic strategies. So, you know, my concerns were more about people falling through the cracks rather than overspending or duplicating what's available at the federal level. It's about recognizing those who are falling through the cracks, recognizing that there are unmet needs, being able to elevate those concerns up at a level where we can do some rethinking, some reinterpretation of the existing literature so we can stretch those programs enough to get to all the young people who need them. I agree with Robert that all of these programs are well-intended, but they're often, you know, kind of designed in this kind of artificial space. And when it gets down to the local level, when it's real families and real services, when it's real programs and real problems, those things don't overlap well enough to be able to meet the needs. So I get excited about the prospects of greater coordination because I think it allows us to achieve the same goal that Robert outlined, which is to get the maximum benefit out of the federal resources. And I often would make the case that better coordination of existing programs gets you a bigger bang for your buck than trying to coordinate new programs, because so much of the federal commitment is already made. And it's about how we squeeze the most out of those programs and get the greatest benefit. And I think you do that through greater coordination and collaboration at the federal level.
I really appreciate both of those perspectives too. It's such a good and grounding reminder to me as I've had different roles throughout my career, whether it was working more directly with young people and families or working at a place like the Federal Office of Management and Budget, that the way we see the problem, the, you know, what it looks like on paper when you line up different programs and agencies, and then what it's like to be a person in a community trying to navigate all of those things and get your needs met, can be really different perspectives and experiences. And it's, you know, both have their place for sure, but of course, ultimately we want good things for the people who are participating in our federal programs. So, and we'll start with you this time, Bryan, since you both have so much experience at senior federal levels, tell us what successful coordination actually looks like.
I think an informal example of coordination and collaboration during my time in the federal government was the relationship that was intentionally built between the folks responsible for child welfare and the folks responsible for running the Medicaid system, right? In order for children in foster care to get access to mental health and physical health services, they access those services through the federal program of Medicaid. And so in that instance, recognizing that there was often a disconnect between meeting the needs of those young people and delivering the services in accordance with policy, we really built out a relationship from the beginning with Medicaid. And in order to do that, The first thing we had to do was to create some regular contact, right? That it couldn't be erratic, it had to be routine. People had to understand that this was a relationship that was gonna be built over time. It had to be goal-oriented. And it really had to be designed around this idea that we were trying to innovate or rethink the way the policies currently operate, right? So we weren't trying to make new policy. We weren't trying to rewrite the legislation. We were trying to look at the full authority that the legislation outlined and find the best way to align the incentives so that kids in the foster care system could get access to the highest quality services possible in a timely fashion. When I was envisioning a solution, if I was envisioning it in a completely different context as the solution that Medicaid was envisioning, then we weren't going to create alignment. And so that meant talking about the programs, talking about real circumstances in which those programs were being introduced, and then talking about the intersection. Where do they most likely come together? And are there strategies that we can use together, right, to create greater access or to make it easier? So that's a great example of it was coordination at the highest levels. There were people that were in appointed positions like myself, as well as career staff around the table on a regular basis, laying out an agenda and really working through an understanding of how to make the program better, how to make things happen better at the local level. Ultimately, that meant communicating across our programs at the federal level. So we sent out communications to child welfare agencies. We communicated with Medicaid departments. We communicated with behavioral health departments across the entire country. We encouraged them to understand the latitude that they had. We encouraged them to innovate and bring ideas forward. We encouraged them to dialogue with us so that we could problem solve directly with them and find solutions that then we could make more available across the country. So that's the kind of pace and pattern I think you have to develop in order to do it well. I don't think it's a meeting that you can do once or twice in an administration and make something happen. It's really about building relationships, building a common understanding of what you're trying to achieve, and then working together around the details so that when you execute the plan, it actually meets the needs of people in the real world.
Well, thank you. And that's a really great segue. As I'll turn to you, Robert, since you have been in that position at the Office of Management and Budget, which can oversee all the many different agencies, to talk a little bit about what successful coordination looks like at that broad federal level.
Bryan's story about making sure that you're in partnership with the ultimate beneficiaries is a really good one. I will say no one's really figured this out. People have often said, why if coordination and collaboration is so important, why isn't it happening? Because it's hard. People would rather stay in their silos and get their work done than have to cede some authority or do work outside their domain in order to accomplish a common objective. It's just harder. What makes it easier is when the president says it's a priority. Mm-hmm. It really does clear a lot of barriers out of the way. A clear understanding of what you're trying to accomplish. I know it sounds pedantic, but what is the outcome, ultimate outcome that we're all trying to achieve? And that really helps you ask yourself, is what we're doing contributing or not? We should be transparent about how well we're doing or how poorly we're doing. Everybody who's got a stake in the program, in the objectives should be at the table, and their roles should be clear, and they should be held accountable to each other on a regular basis for getting the work done to accomplish that objective. I think a magic combination I've seen is where a relevant agency or department executive combined with someone from OMB or another official at the White House, it really does likewise clear away a lot of barriers that might otherwise present themselves. I think some of the challenges to getting to the ground. Again, this multiplicity of programs that, as Bryan mentioned, have different eligibility criteria and make it really hard for people on the ground to access. Another challenge is the accountability ecosystem that's developed around mm-hmm. programs. There's an inspector general, the Government Accountability Office, the Single Audit Act, all of which kind of scare program mm-hmm. recipients into feeling restricted from doing the kinds of outside the box thinking that Bryan talked about. So a better compact with that community, I think, is a necessary step that we've not yet really figured out how to overcome. But those are some of the criteria that I see it in, we did it around security clearance reform. That's a very internal federal kind of activity, much easier. Veterans homelessness is another commonly used example of where the relevant agencies, namely HUD and Veterans Affairs, collaborated, they were transparent, and really whacked away at that problem over time.
I think that Robert is exactly right in the examples that he provided in terms of those high leverage opportunities. However, I think that those examples, I don't want those examples to be the end all to the examples that people think about, because any administration, any White House is, they're going to have three or four priorities. OMB is going to be able to have three or four priorities. There's a whole bunch of other stuff going on in the federal government, but those three or four priorities, and I want the whole bunch of other people to be taking note of what's happening in those high profile examples and going out and doing the same thing. All the people I worked with in the White House, great people, they were always going to care about these young people, but it was never going to be on that list of the top five. It just wasn't, right? And so if we waited only for that validation from the White House or permission from the White House to go out and work with others, or wait for the secretary alone to tell us to go do something, there was going to be a missed opportunity. I agree with Robert. And once again, I want to push folks to think beyond those that are going to get that unique elevation that happens in the White House, and push people to think much more comprehensively about what's possible.
Bryan, I'm feeling inspired by sort of this theme of maximizing the program we have, maximizing the resources and the coordination, and maximizing our opportunities to lead from wherever we are. That is kind of a good segue into a particular proposal, actually, that I'd love to hear the thoughts on from both of y'all. So this idea that so often children and youth don't, even though everyone loves to talk about children and youth and loves children and youth, hopefully, the idea that often those issues aren't the ones that rise into those very top priorities when push comes to shove, when it comes to funding or it comes to picking a goal, is something that many people have noticed. And so the Forum for Youth Investment, Nemours, a number of other organizations have come together and are really supporting the concept of a White House Office for Children and Youth. And then also having what is often called a federal children's cabinet. I'd love to hear your thoughts about what you think about that approach and what kinds of things you think an entity like that or a different one that you might suggest might be able to accomplish, especially as we look at how the pandemic, the health pandemic, and then of course the pandemic of systemic racism has really ravaged or deepened the chasms in many places that already exist across America in so many different ways based on lines of race equity and also other life experiences that people have. So what do you think of that idea, and how could you see it playing a role really practically going forward?
I think the proposal you laid out mirrors a lot of some of the qualities that Bryan and I think agree include the ingredients for success. Mm-hmm. So it's got high level support. Bryan invited you to get after it. irrespective of that authority. And I often say, if I knew at the beginning of my career in government what I knew at the end, I would have been dangerous. Because you don't need permission to do a lot of what you want to do. But having it really does help. Having everybody, the relevant players at the table, bringing prominence to the issue, I think is important. People who can move government being involved, being at the table and involved in the conversation, really important. You know, the Forum for Youth Investment is, in my mind, one of the most impressive advocacy, you know, the engine, little engine that could, that I've ever worked with. So you've been able to move Congress, move administrations of both parties. And I think, you know, having y'all at the table, having that kind of expertise in the way Washington works, I think is really important.
Yeah, I think that the components that you describe, you know, they could sit in a variety of places, but I think having the visibility is critical. Some coordination at the federal level increases the likelihood that you get the kind of coordination you need at the local level, so that a school who has a young person who they find out is homeless realizes that there are other resources than just the McKinney-Vento Act that young person is eligible for. If folks at the federal level aren't talking about those programs and how you might coordinate them, it's all the more difficult for folks at the local level to know that those programs exist and have a way to coordinate them. I also think that if you've got an entity like that, you create some shared accountability, right? So it's now not Bryan Samuels' responsibility to make this happen. It's Bryan Samuels plus four other folks who come together and do that work. And I think that shared accountability, I think, encourages people to be a little bit more ambitious, push against the limits a little harder. Ultimately, I think you get a bigger impact. I also think if you had an entity like this, you might begin to see some common kind of technical fixes that you could go to Congress and say, not as a single program, if you fix this, I could do A, B, and C. But if you could make some small fixes across three or four programs, boy, we could have a bigger impact.
Can I add one point to just build on something that Bryan said? He mentioned Congress, and we haven't talked a lot about that. But in my experience, integrating Congress into your path to progress pays enormous dividends. So they're with you when you identify barriers. They're with you when you fall short of your aggressive objectives, and they know the basis for that. But they can also help with the accountability community and say, we were at the table, we've observed, they've kept us apprised, and this is not a time to call them out for some unfair accountability shortcoming. This is a time to all be rowing in the same direction.
I'd love to close this out by going back to something that you really emphasized in the beginning, Bryan, and Robert, you kind of underscored when you heard Bryan talk about it, but really closing that loop between the federal government, which is often in this very distant and removed set of entities, it's hard to understand, and the real people and real families that we all are, of course, living out in the world and in a community, especially you know, people who are part of a community or a family where they may not work for the federal government or, you know how all the rules and things go. Do you think that there's a role for an entity like a White House office or a federal children's cabinet for making the federal government more responsive to the real life needs and perspectives of, you know, what the world is really like, what life is really like, what it's really like to, you know, try and pull together your housing and your child support and your job and your transportation and everything? How can those pieces come together?
I think a coordinating council or coordinating office is really in a position to be both able to interact at the federal level and create avenues for communications with communities local leaders, state leaders who are facing real challenges. The other point that I would make here, the kind of coordinating entity that you described earlier might also really put some discipline into understanding the developmental trajectory that young people are on. A coordinating entity that sees this child more complexly, but also sees them developmentally across time is really critical. So that you know that where you're making those investments across developmental stages, that they're coordinated in a way that you're likely to improve that trajectory of that young person. And that if they didn't get what they needed at 3 to 5 years old, there are other opportunities them to make up for that. We know in the brain science that there's real growth across the entire developmental spectrum. And if you're convening a group that can really think that expansively and then tailor and coordinate their strategies, I think you just increase the likelihood that young people don't fall between the cracks.
Mm-hmm. So much study has been done about what communities, jurisdictions have to go through to get access to federal dollars that are in different siloed pockets across programs and agencies of the government. But then it's even more difficult when they actually get the money and how they can or can't commingle it, what they can use it for, what they can't use it for, what if they get tripped up, the kind of accountability thunder that comes down. That's all those challenges have been studied to death. Pitiful little work has been done to actually overcome those barriers. We've got the performance partnership pilot experience, mm-hmm. which was mm-hmm. intended to commingle resources, allow communities access, but it's just, that's almost underscored the complexity of the challenges. Mm-hmm. So I think with the explicit responsibility, clear goal to sort of help bridge the divide between the on the folks on the ground actually delivering these benefits and those overseeing them, I think it's got to be almost core to the mission of that group.
Great. Well, thank you both so much. I am so appreciative for your time and your thoughtful insights. Again, coming from these very different and in so many ways really complementary perspectives. Thank you for sharing your insights with all of us today. And so with that, we'll close it out and I'll hand it back over to you, Daniela.
It's now my pleasure to turn to Nathaniel Katz, who is the Senior Vice President of Behavioral Health Innovation for Mental Health America. And he's also a clinical assistant professor for the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Health Sciences at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. Nathaniel will facilitate our panel.
Thank you so much, Daniela. And now it's my turn to introduce our wonderful panel for the day. First, we have Bruce Leslie is the president of First Focus on Children and directs policy development and internal operations at the organization. Previously, he spent 12 years on Capitol Hill, where he worked on healthcare, education, human services, and immigration issues in several different capacities. In addition to his service at the federal level, Leslie worked at the state and county levels of government on health and human services policy for Texas State Representative Mary Polk, El Paso County Judge Pat O'Rourke, and Texas Governor Ann Richards in the Texas Office of State Federal Relations in Washington, D.C. And then you've already been introduced to Daniela Gratali, the director of the Office of Child Health Policy and Advocacy at Nemours Children's Health System. In that capacity, she directs federal policy and legislative work with the U.S. Congress and the administration. Previously, she worked in the nonprofit sector at the Trust for America's Health, an advocacy organization focused on strengthening the public health system. Prior to that, she spent a year and a half on Capitol Hill. So I'm so excited to get into this panel. So I have a few questions for you to start us off. So Bruce, I was hoping you could talk about, we know the past year has been a very challenging time for children, youth, and families. And we've heard from prior panelists about some of the bright spots at the state level that have helped to coordinate our nation's response. What do you see as the policy bright spots or silver linings since the onset of the pandemic at the federal level that could create positive change.
Thank you so much, Nathaniel. It's great to be a part of this panel. And yes, I will just point out a few things. First of all, the share of federal spending for kids has been declining dramatically over the past number of years, and it's dropped to an all-time low, 7.48% of the federal budget. So a couple of important things is that the president's budget that was just recently released would actually increase the federal share of spending for kids. And his American Families Plan that hasn't yet been put into legislation, but was aspects of it were passed as part of the American Relief Plan, included things like expanding and improving the child tax credit, which and that package would cut child poverty by more than half. And so in the American Families Plan, the child tax credit would be made permanent, and that really that helps almost about 90% of families with children in this country. It also provides for universal preschool, invests in childcare, increase support for education and childcare providers, creates a national paid family medical leave program, reduces child hunger and improves child nutrition, and expands the Affordable Care Act family care tax credits, and also makes expands access to college. So pulling all those provisions together is just an enormous improvement in the lives of children.
Wonderful. And then for Daniela, you know, we just went through a whole list of incredible policy changes. And I was hoping you could tell me about how Nemours and your leading partner organizations have worked together to develop a proposal for the Biden administration to maximize the impact of the current and future policies through through enhanced alignment and coordination.
Thanks, Nathaniel. So I think Bruce gave a really solid overview of a lot of the ways that Congress and the administration have worked together to begin to respond. It certainly has been a very challenging year for children and families, but I think one that also presents great opportunity, not only for the relief policies that focus on the short term, but in the long term, to really think about what are the structures that we need to have in place that will help us to best coordinate and align all of these policies and to maximize implementation so that we really do have positive impacts on the lives of children and youth. So over the past year, Nemours and our partners have conducted a series of interviews and virtual convenings with folks who've served at the state and local level, as well as the federal level. And the goal really has been to try to get a sense of what they think works. And I have to say that children's cabinets have certainly emerged as a bright spot at the state and local level. These coordinating entities that help folks come together and to think about how do we maximize implementation so that once policy actually makes it to the children and families who need the governmental programs and services, that it's done in a way that feels aligned and feels coordinated and is reducing duplication and really just maximizing effectiveness and efficiency. So we saw a lot of synergy in the priorities of Nemours. Of course, you're both of your organizations, Mental Health America and First Focus. And then we've also partnered with the Forum for Youth Investment, the Harvard Ed Redesign Lab, and Children's Funding Project. And together we came up with a three-pronged proposal. The first piece is really calling for a point person at the Domestic Policy Council. Ideally, that would be an office on children and youth, but we really think having someone within the White House whose sole focus is thinking about implementation and development of policy for children and youth would be very impactful. But of course, one person alone cannot have the type of impact that we need. So that's why we think elevating what we've seen works at the state and local level in the form of a federal children's cabinet would help us to cut across all the different departments and sectors and silos and really come together with a coordinated strategy for children and youth. And finally, we've all embraced the idea of a White House conference on children and youth to help shed light on some of the biggest issues that children and families are facing today. So we have really come together to advocate for this proposal. We've put out policy briefs, op-eds and blogs. We have two national sign-on letters, one that went to the transition team last year and another one that's actually under development right now that will go to the Biden administration shortly. And we are looking for sign-on and invite your organizations to participate. And we've done some meetings with the administration as well. And we just really look forward to continuing to engage with other partners as well.
Thank you, Dale. It sounds like really impactful and exciting work. And so for Bruce, I wanted to ask, what are some of the policy areas over the past few years or even decades where it seems like a White House office on children and youth and a federal children's cabinet would have improved the coordination and helped improve the health and well-being of children and youth?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's a number of things that would be really, that would really benefit kids if policy was coordinated in a better holistic manner. We all think about kids in ways where we kind of pull apart the different aspects of their lives, right? So with their education, early childhood, healthcare. But if you coordinate it across, or if you think about the whole child, you really could improve the lives of kids. So if you, for example, if you want to address child poverty in America, it takes more than just thinking about the child tax credit. You also need to think about things like child nutrition programs, housing programs, things like that, that all impact family poverty in this country. In COVID, for example, during the pandemic, it would have been enormously beneficial to have coordination on policy for kids. There was, at the beginning of the pandemic and the economic recession, there was definitely sort of a myth that kids were fine. And as all of us who work on children's issues, we know that every aspect of the lives of kids was negatively impacted. And so if you think about the fact that there were school closures and childcare center closures, and there's been, as a result, there's been all kinds of issues around education, but also mental health and other important aspects of children's lives. We don't even really know at this point sort of the ramifications of what's going on with respect to child abuse and neglect in this country and homelessness and what the impact this has all had on that. So if you coordinated those policies across those things, you would really have improved things for kids during the pandemic. And even now, the vaccine rollout was for adults first, and now we are at a point where now kids are eligible for the vaccines, and we still don't have a national plan for that. And a rollout for kids is just inherently different than that for adults. And so yesterday, the administration laid out a goal of getting 70% of adults vaccinated, but there is no similar plan for kids at this point. And so it really would be hugely beneficial. All the stuff that Daniela talked about, like, we had a national a White House office on children and youth, or we had a children's cabinet or a coordinator role in the administration for kids, it would be enormously beneficial. And last, just even things like just making sure that you raise inherent equity issues for kids. And so, for example, at the federal level, every single federal health program is permanent. So if you think about Medicare, Medicaid, veteran, the VA system, the Indian Health Service, federal employees health benefits, just name a federal health benefits program and they're all permanent. There's one that isn't, and it's the Children's Health Insurance Program. And 10 million kids are served by that. And yet we have to constantly go back again and again to get it reauthorized. And so those are just examples of how if you had a coordinator sort of highlighting these inequities and needs that are specific and unique to kids, it would really benefit children and families in the long term.
Thank you so much, Bruce. I think we want to look forward, going to the future. What are some of the areas where you think these coordinating structures could be particularly impactful, Daniela?
So I think Bruce hit on a lot of them. I mean, certainly as we emerge from the pandemic, we'll be thinking about child poverty and a lot of the programs that exist right now through the American Rescue Plan. How do we maximize implementation? I would say three particular areas certainly are the youth and child mental health crisis that we're experiencing. I think that's going to require coordination from not just mental health professionals, but school professionals, from early child care providers, the whole range of professionals that and providers who address the needs of children will need to be involved. And of course, certainly families. I think as we rebuild the childcare sector, that will also take a lot of multi-sector and interdepartmental coordination. And I think in addition to issues just specific to children, having a coordinating structure and a point person will also help us think about any time an issue comes up, what is the impact on children and how do we make sure that this policy is implemented in a way that is also beneficial to children. So something like the Precision Medicine Initiative, for example, that's really focused on the adult population for the most part to date. Having someone who's really laser focused on what does this mean for children will be really helpful. So I think it's a combination of identifying the issues that really do need a laser focus because they are very impactful on the lives of children and youth, and pairing that with what is the child and family perspective on all issues across the federal government to make sure that we're really doing our best to give children and families the healthy start that they deserve.
Wonderful. Well, I, for one, am sold on the need. And so I was hoping now you could discuss how interested organizations can engage in efforts to advocate for policies to support children's health and well-being, as well as this specific initiative to establish a White House Office on Children and Youth and a federal children's cabinet.
There's a number of things that organizations can do. For example, one of the things that's come, you know, that's happening right now is there's, and during the week of June 13th through the 19th, there's Children's Week. And so one of the things we're really trying to do is really raise awareness about how every issue, policy issue, really is a kids issue. And so I think if people wanted to engage, it would be really helpful for people to sort of highlight the issues that are important to kids during this week with respect to policy, and so that policymakers really understand. Kids are often an afterthought in public policy. You know, earlier we talked, I mentioned CHIP, for example. And what would be really great is for policymakers to really understand that almost any issue that comes before them, there's actually a children's angle that's unique and needs to be addressed. And so that's one of the things we're doing here this week during Children's Week, is really pointing out those issues that are critical to kids. Other things that organizations can do is they can join some of the coalitions that involves national and state groups. So for example, the Children's Budget Coalition really works on all the funding issues at the federal level for kids. But then there's also like the Child Poverty Action Group is another example, which has state and federal groups working to try to, with the goal of trying to cut child poverty in half in this country. Kind of other things that advocates can do is really think about system changes. And so it's exactly the stuff that Daniela earlier around really pushing for creating coordinating functions in federal agencies. Another thing that would be really great for the federal government to do is to require that when regulations are passed, that the agency must consider children. And so they must have a child impact statement. So what would this regulation do, and what would it be its impact on kids, and does there need to be different things that are taken into account there? And also we would hope that government at all levels would adopt a best interest standard for children. It seems sort of logical, and yet we constantly have policy that actually fails kids. And so if we adopted a best interest standard, for example, you would not have separated families at the border, for example. That was not good for children in so many ways. And so we really think that would be, it sort of gets to the idea of, you know, who's really for kids and who's just kidding, right? And if you kind of had a best interest standard, that would be beneficial. So those are some things that I think organizations could engage with and really move the ball forward for children in this country.
I built on that great list from Bruce. The Office of Management and Budget has a request for information out focused on equity, hugely important. And I think that equity really does need to begin with children and families. So we'd encourage folks to take a look at that and to submit comments and to make sure that children have an important perspective and families and that's really considered in this RFI. If you'd like to engage specifically in the work that our organizations have collectively done together on an Office of Children and Youth, we do have a website. It's nemours.org/WH Office for Kids. And you'll see that on the screen. And we'd love for you to visit the website. We have all of our policy briefs and blogs and op-eds are there. If you would like to engage in any of those activities, feel free to send us your blogs, your publications. We'd love to see them. There'll be a button soon on the website to sign on to our new letter to the Biden administration. It's an organizational sign-on letter, so we encourage you to take a look at it and certainly invite you to join us. You can join our listserv on there as well, too. So again, I encourage you to actively engage. And finally, I think social media is important. So you could definitely use social media to amplify messages about kids in general or about this specific effort to really push for coordinating structures for children and youth. So I think there are a lot of ways to engage. Been really optimistic about the future. I think there are a lot of folks who really are considering the impact of the pandemic on children and certainly want to come together to maximize implementation of these policies. And if we can work together and get some coordinating structures in line that help us to put an equity lens on that and that help us to really amplify not just the voices of folks in government, but also of children and youth themselves, and to better coordinate between federal level entities, state level entities, local entities, I think we'll really see some positive changes.
Thank you so much, Danielle and Bruce. And with that, let's transition to our live question and answer session.
Hello, so great to join everyone. So we're really excited to be here with a subset of our partners. I did want to introduce a couple of our partners who have just joined us. So we have Jennifer Davis from the Harvard Graduate School of Education. She's at the Education Redesign Lab. Jennifer, will you please say hello? And we also are now joined by Dr. Chris Gable, who is an assistant clinical professor of pediatrics in the Division of Emergency Medicine at The Ohio State University. And he's a pediatric doctor in the ER at Nationwide Children's Hospital. So I'm just so thrilled to be joined by a great set of panelists. Let me start with Jennifer. Jennifer, are you able to hear me? I just want to double check.
Yes.
Great. So could you please speak to some of the bright spots at the local level with regard to children's cabinets, particularly in response to the COVID-19 pandemic and the work that they've done around equity? Because I think we've already heard a lot about the work at the state and federal level, but I'd love to hear from you about some work at the local level.
Thank you so much. Well, the Education Redesign Lab at Harvard Graduate School of Education has partnered with the Children's Funding Project and the Forum for Youth Investment in order to support communities across the country to put in place effective children's cabinets. And more than 40 communities across the country have them in place, and they have served such an essential role, particularly in the last year, almost a de facto situation room in many communities to address the multitude of challenges, from collaborating around the delivery of meals to computers and hotspots, to setting up childcare sites for essential workers, all kinds of health supports, vaccinations, and they've raised significant resources in order to meet the needs of children and to address the inequities that we have across the country. Now with the American Rescue Plan funds, this essential work is going to continue, and many of the communities are putting in place very significant summer enrichment programs for kids, again, to help kids catch up on learning loss, to be able to address some of the mental health challenges and social emotional issues that they're facing. 112 community-based organizations are being coordinated, for example, in Louisville to address some of the summer learning and other issues. So, schools alone cannot address these inequities, cannot address the challenges of COVID and the pandemic and all the challenges around mental health. So these kind of collaborations across the country are essential. And just to put a plug in, if we had a federal children's cabinet, that collaboration would be much easier because there would be a similar structure in place to do the coordination that we need.
Great, thank you. So let's stay on the topic of equity. I want to switch over to Dr. Walker now. So Dr. Walker, as I mentioned earlier, the Biden administration has put out an executive order focused on equity, and there's a new request for information as well on a whole of government approach. Can you speak to how you think a federal children's cabinet might be helpful in addressing equity?
Absolutely. Thanks for this opportunity to chat more. And I think what we really know is that we have to figure out how to address inequities to emerge better from the pandemic, to really figure out how to measure and create accountability. Where we spend our money matters. And if we can assess it across agencies, a sense of where dollars can be synergized, combined, and create that joint accountability, which in order to create impact truly is important. So this RFI is an opportunity for others to weigh in around how this kind of infrastructure would allow alignment for children that is focused on racial equity. And we really do believe creating measures, metrics, understanding where there's duplication, understanding where the commitment is, and understanding where there's underfunding will also help us understand these compound opportunities to look across systems, to look across education, labor, and multiple sectors. And certainly when we think about health, we know that education, mental health, economics are all interconnected. So this is a great opportunity for us to weigh in.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Walker. And now let's go to the other physician on our panel, Dr. Gable. So Dr. Gable, given your role as a pediatric doctor in the emergency room, I think you have a very unique lens into the lives of children and families. And you've advocated for a White House office on children and youth. Can you speak to how you think such an office would help to improve the lives of children and youth, both in your community, but also across the nation?
Thank you, Danielle. That's an excellent question. The emergency department is a window into the health of a community, like illnesses infecting children, traumas, burns, asthma, even more emergent things. It's all how, you know, accidental overdoses, suicides, these reflect the challenges of your community and the strengths and flaws in the policies that ultimately govern them. And so much affecting the patients is decided well before I see them. There are preventative regulations such as air and water in the neighborhood, and the walkability and safety of your streets to prevent traumas, and then the regulations more specific to the care itself, whether your neighborhood doctor accepts your insurance, the pediatric residence, readiness of your local ER, the affordability of the insulin or asthma medications. Lots of things that have to happen before I ever see these patients in the ER. And that's why it's so important to have a department like the Office of Child and Family Policy that can strengthen the funding and oversight and critical investments that are crucial to the growth and productivity of children. Promoting cross-agency collaboration and leverage interagency authorities to further evidence-based programs with direct benefits for children. The creation of a federal children's cabinet would also ensure stronger coordination and data sharing between federal and state level officials, provide multiple community leaders, including children's hospitals, with critical expertise and resources to expand collaborative efforts. A strong national agency devoted to children and youth would improve effectiveness, efficiency, and sustainability of our investments nationwide, and would serve as a strong signal to the nation that our children and families have a champion devoted to their achievements.
Well, thank you, Dr. Gable. That's very well said. And thank you for taking your time out of your busy time in the ER. So I think building on that, let me turn to Nathaniel Count. So I think Dr. Gable mentioned some real world issues that children and youth are currently facing. And I know you have a lot of expertise, of course, in mental and behavioral health. So I was hoping you could speak a little bit to some of the unique challenges that children and families have faced due to the COVID pandemic. And from the perspective of Mental Health America, what are some of the things that you think the Biden and Harris administration, as well as Congress, could do to help address the youth mental health crisis?
So just last week, the CDC released a report finding that suicide attempts among adolescent girls increased by 50% since the previous year, which is just absolutely horrifying. And there's been previous studies, I think, finding parent-rated mental health among adolescents dramatically worsening. And so there's quite a lot of evidence coming out that the COVID pandemic, besides like the sort of like obvious and intuitive challenges that it posed for children. And then unfortunately we have, you know, much less evidence about the mental health and well-being of younger children. They're not routinely surveyed and parent reports, you know, given over the phone kind of miss some of those challenges. So we only have a very incomplete picture of how younger children are doing. So we think the big opportunity is as children return to school and early care and education in different settings, more routine use of primary care, there are these opportunities to address and mitigate the traumas and adversities that children faced during COVID and, you know, put them back on a track towards solid social functioning. But in order to accomplish that, we need, you know, coordinated systems where your education, like your Every Student Succeeds Act plans and your IDEA funding and your Medicaid and your Family First Preventive Services Act, all these things work in tandem to support families and your Head Start dollars so that they have a coordinated system of supports rather than what it often is now, where it's like, instead of the no wrong door, it's like the every wrong door, where it's, you know, a continuous series of endless wait lists to the point where, like, you know, when you talk to some communities, they're like, just stop trying to help us. Like, we just get more wait lists and more, you know, things that don't actually confer value, just more 3-hour intakes that are far away and hard to get to with no service provided at the end. So I think that's the real opportunity, is to deliver something of value to families that do kind of address the adversities that so many faced.
Thanks. And building on that, Mary Ellen, two-part question. First, what would you suggest should be some initial priorities for a federal children's cabinet and White House Office on Children and Youth? And also, how do you think currently what we're learning about what works in states at state level cabinets, how can that information be transferred across state lines so that we're really leveraging success and learning from each other?
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Daniela. So I think that the first place to focus would be on, you know, the huge funding and opportunities that are going on now through the American Rescue Plan and potentially through other federal funding that may be in the pipeline. It's a tremendous amount to coordinate. It requires a much higher level of capacity than both states and localities necessarily have to have for the amount of funds that they typically get. There are lots of plans to do. There's all kinds of stuff going on. So there's not really a coordinated venue of feds thinking about, all right, how does all this wonderful, you know, funding these opportunities across programs and agencies, how do they fit together? How can we present guidance? How can we present plans? How can we present an opportunity for feedback, for questions, for technical assistance in a way that's really coherent and comes from the perspective of what will this look like to the state, to the community that's actually having all this come at them inbound and trying to figure out what to do with it? So really helping all of these diverse jurisdictions that are, of course, trying to make the most of these funds, figure out what that can look like and to speak to them with one voice. A great example is mental health. We've had states talk to us about how there can be mental health guidance that's just not aligned or is confusing across all the different programs where mental health is relevant, you know, from healthcare settings to school settings to other places. And so having a way to have coherent mental health guidance that really applies across all settings and that states and localities and other people who are implementing these funds can look to one place for would be really helpful. And that's just one example. So I think that's really the top place to look. I think that also, you know, when you have coordinating bodies like, you know, that can sit at a higher level than the ones that already exist, so like a federal one versus a state one, it's really helpful to then be able to share best practices, to think about how to translate opportunities for what's working in one system or one state to other places. At the Forum for Youth Investment, we run a state children's cabinet network, so we're certainly able to support and facilitate some of that. But the federal government could have so much more impact and think about how to respond on their end through their policy.
The final thing I would note is that, you know, something we see all the time, especially in states and localities, is that the role of bringing young people in to express their own needs and influence policy is extremely powerful, very important, and often absent. So I know part of the proposal is to have a youth and family advisory board that could actually represent the diversity of young people in the United States, very racially diverse across socioeconomic lines, LGBTQIA+, and other identities and life experiences, urban, rural, and suburban, and tribal reservation backgrounds and growing up experiences, to really have a place for the federal government to hear from young people themselves about what life looks like holistically, and what are the kinds of supports that they need, what are the kinds of solutions that they have to offer. Often our young people tremendously undertapped and underutilized as a creative resource for problem solving.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. So we have about a minute or two left, and I want to turn to two questions related to, I guess this will be our lightning round, related to financing. So Josh, starting with you, it'd be great to hear from you a little bit about how you think a coordinating entity at the federal level could be helpful to states and localities in terms of actually bringing funding streams together so that there could be a more coherent and consistent and aligned approach at the state and local level.
Absolutely. So, you know, if you are, you know, a lot of the federal funds that different agencies put out flow to state and local governments who then are really trying to solve problems on the ground. And it can be a real struggle when they are, you know, maybe, you know, let's take an issue like asthma. There might be funding streams from the, you know, housing and education, you know, agencies that are in charge of housing, education, public health, transportation, the environment. And all of these funding streams have different requirements, different reporting, and maybe different even, target populations in terms of who they're intended to serve. And so it becomes a real challenge for, you know, states and local governments to turn that funding into a comprehensive approach that can really make an impact. And so, you know, a federal children's cabinet, a White House office on children and youth, could really bring together all of these federal agencies that are focused on a single issue, whether it's asthma, it could be the COVID pandemic for children and youth, or any other issue, and to really align the requirements around these funding streams and the target populations and really the overall goals to ensure that they are moving in the same direction. And you know, this could be through specific waivers and pilot programs, or just generally overall trying to make funding streams more aligned. So it could really increase the impact that is occurring and just really make it easier for state and local government to serve the populations that they are trying to serve.
Thanks, Josh. And building off of that, Bruce, last question is for you. I think OMB can also play an important role in coordination around funding. So can you speak to some of your suggestions in that realm? Bruce, I can't hear you. I think you're on mute.
Thanks, sorry. I would say that there's three major things that OMB can and should do for kids. So one role, obviously, is that the Office of Management and Budget and the Congressional Budget Office do jointly is sort of, you know, monitor the funding for kids in the government. And so OMB puts forth the president's budget. And one of the great things in this last budget submission was a significant increase in funding proposed for things like the child tax credit and education funding, early childhood. So one thing is just putting forth the plan to really, you know, we all know that money matters and making investments in kids. The second thing they can do is, you know, we've all been talking about the importance of coordinating across systems of government for kids. Kids do not live in silos, and we need to think holistically about them. So one of the things the Office of Management and Budget can do is encourage the creation of child impact statements that we talked about earlier in the previous panel, where agencies, when they put forth rules and plans, really think about and look into what are the specific issues and unique things that are important to kids. And do they, you know, kids are not little adults and they have unique situations that regulations should address. And then the last thing they can do is OMB has something they call cross-agency priorities or CAPs. And they can make those for all kinds of things. And it would be really fantastic if OMB created a CAP for children and really thought about kids across all the agencies and prioritize kids in the government.
Well said. Well, I want to thank you all. This concludes our briefing. I also want to say a special thank you to Senator King, Senator Carper, Bryan Samuels, and Robert Shea for also joining us today. A recording will be available. The link to the recording will be available at nemours.org/WH Office for Kids. Also on that site, you can find the link to our sign-on letter to the Biden-Harris administration, as well as a lot of other materials. Thank you all for joining us today, and hope you all have a nice day.